Grand solar minimum, global warming, mini ice age. I'm sure if you've been doing what Nana's been telling you to do, which is take some time every week and get online and you know, be aware of what's happening in your world, in your country, in your city, town, county, you will have come across the term grand solar minimum. What is it exactly? Well, the first thing I'm going to have to show you is what a solar cycle is. Because really what's happening happens all the time. So let me just explain to you. Let's learn about what a solar cycle is first. Before I can explain to you what a grand solar minimum is, I gotta first make sure you understand what a solar cycle is. So, roughly every 11 years, the sun's magnetic field completely flips. This means that the sun's north and south poles switch places. It then takes approximately another 11 years for the sun's north and south poles to flip back again. Now, one of the ways they track the solar cycle is by counting the number of sunspots. The beginning of a solar cycle is a solar minimum when the sun has the least amount of sunspots. Over time, the solar activity and the number of sunspots increase. The middle of the solar cycle is called the solar maximum. This is when the sun has the most sunspots. As the cycle ends, it fades back to the solar minimum, and then the cycle begins all over again. Okay, what you see here is a list of the last 11 solar events, maximums or minimums. These are the events that are notated in the cosmic record. There are 11 of them. Now you see two of those are highlighted. Those were grand events. The Homeric minimum back in 950 BC and 800 BC, and the Maunder minimum in 1645 and 1715. These were major events. The Maunder event in particular, because at that time we were really able to keep good records. And we're going to talk about that event a little bit later. Okay, so what happens during a solar minimum, and in particular, a grand solar minimum? What happens is more of the cosmic rays enter the Earth's atmosphere. Now, these rays, they collide with the atmospheric atoms, and they disassociate in a cascading mode into smaller subatomic particles. Now, these particles act like a cloud and propagate low-level cloud formations. Some of these particles even reach the Earth's surface and penetrate it. More cosmic rays means accelerated storm formation, erratic rainfall, snowstorms, hail, local flooding, and in the long run, global cooling. We should probably also add to that earthquakes, volcanoes, lightning, and all kinds of other electrical events. And due to the low magnetic protection, the electromagnetic field, we then become in an enhanced risk for solar flare that can disrupt our power grid. So here's where things get kind of confusing, because even though we're in a grand solar minimum, which is actually a cooler phase, grand solar minimums are historically prone to drought. And due to the jet stream disturbances, they bring on heat waves and wildfire increases, flooding, which there's where it gets confusing. How can you be in a drought and flood? And we're going to learn about that here in a minute. So it's actually these erratic weather changes and these extremes that disrupt the agriculture and the civilization. Frost and snow events and crop failures can be devastating, as they were in the Maunder event. A normal grand solar minimum does not manifest initially as a mini ice age, but more so as a bad weather age. Okay, so how does this affect you in particular? Well, because of that whole jet stream disturbance things, that's going to cause increased cloud cover, and that increased cloud cover means less sea surface water heating. Now, what the less sea surface water heating means is that then there is less evaporation of the seawater. So that significantly reduces our humidity levels. So, in a grand solar minimum, local droughts and crop failure can be caused not only by less rain and more winds, but simply by lower humidity levels. And these humidity levels don't even show up in the climate records like temperature and precipitation does. Such droughts will most likely be misinterpreted as a drought from the warming and evaporation. So, besides having already experienced all that flooding and drought, the other thing we're experiencing is this increase in UV radiation. Okay, due to the geomagnetic field strength, which is weak during a solar minimum, more cosmic rays from space are also let in. This is UV radiation from the sun. The Earth's thermosphere, that's the upper atmosphere of the Earth, is heated mainly by EUV, which means extreme ultraviolet waves from the sun. What this means for us, like we already know, is long-term exposure to the sun's light right now without protection increases a person's risk of skin cancer and other dangerous cellular affliction. So wear your sunscreen, people. Of course, they've been telling us to do that for quite a few many years, and this is why. Now, not only do we get skin cancer from being bombarded by these very strong cosmic rays, but not wearing your sunglasses and protective eyewear can cause cataracts to form, and it can cause a condition called photokeratitis, which is also known as arc eye or snow blindness. These are serious long-term conditions besides the cataracts, and you need to make sure your babies are wearing them too. Okay, for the last 8 minutes, I really haven't told you anything you already knew. We've kind of been living through this for the last 20 years in particular. So what is it? What are the parameters that they set to determine when we are in a grand solar minimum? You know, what line keeps us from crying wolf? So the grand solar minimum should only be officially declared after it has already started. That's after more than one very low cycle. Since we are dealing with several new settings in the Earth's environment, nobody really knows for sure whether we're already in the grand solar minimum or whether it might rebound, at least for a time. So basically, here is what the science is telling us today. In all likelihood, the currently very weak solar cycle that we're in solar cycle number 24, within the next 2 years, because this cycle really doesn't end until like 30 years from now, it's going to give us, in the next 2 years, it's going to really tell us where we're going to land come solar cycle 25. See, in early 2018, the sunspot activity had already reached the level that they had predicted for 2020. So in 2018, it was already dropped way further than they predicted. So here's what we got coming our way. We've got stronger storms, stronger winds, we got hail, we got crop failure due to droughts and flooding. We have earthquakes and volcanoes, and in the long run, global cooling. Add to this all the electric discharge events, and we're looking at meteors that can come into our atmosphere a lot further than they could before, as well as solar flares that can disrupt our power grid and put us all in the dark. So here is what science is saying about global warming versus grand solar minimum. The proponents of that false dogma of climate change or global warming, they're predicting the same climate extremes as you can expect with a grand solar minimum, except for that long-term cooling. But they attribute them to all the wrong causes. Now, Al Gore continues to ponder the theory of anthropogenic global warming. That's global warming caused by humans, even though there has not been any warming in 17 years. Now, if the trends in cosmic ray flux continue, like science predicts that it will, many of Al Gore's gloomy predictions will come true, except for the long-term warming. And the people that are on the fence of whether climate change is real will quickly find out that it is very real. In fact, it will have nothing or little to do with the quote-unquote human greenhouse gases. Now, this is Professor Valentina Sharkova. She's one of the most noted scientists in this field. And here is exactly what she says. I'm going to read it word for word. Quote-unquote, we will see it from 2020 to 2053, when the three next cycles will be of a very reduced magnetic field of the sun. Basically, what happens is these two waves, they separate into the opposite hemispheres, and they will not be interacting with each other, which means that the resulting magnetic field will drop dramatically, nearly to zero. And this will be similar to the conditions like in the Maunder minimum. What will happen to the Earth remains to be seen and predicted, because nobody has developed any program or any model of terrestrial response. They're all based on a period when the sun has maximum activity, when the sun has these nice fluctuations, and its magnetic field is very strong. But we're approaching the stage when the magnetic field of the sun is going to be very, very small. So let's expound a little bit on what that Maunder minimum was. The most famous grand solar minimum of all is undoubtedly the Maunder minimum, which endured from approximately 1645 until 1720. It was named after Edward Maunder, a 19th century astronomer who painstakingly reconstructed European sunspot observation. The Maunder minimum has become synonymous with the term Little Ice Age, a period of climate cooling that, according to some definitions, endured from 1300 to 1850. But reached its chilliest point in that 17th century mark. The temperatures plummeted in Europe, the growing season became shorter by more than a month, and the number of snowy days increased from just a few to about 20 or 30. The ground froze to several feet, the alpine glaciers advanced all over the world, glaciers in the Swiss Alps encroached on farms and buried villages, tree lines in the Alps dropped, seaports were blocked by sea ice that surrounded Iceland and Holland with about 20 miles of ice. Wine and grape harvest diminished, and cereal grain harvest failed, all leading to mass famines. So there you have it. I put a lot of work into that, so I hope you did learn something. So here's what the scientists are telling us to do. Because basically, if you didn't get it, with the information I just gave you, they're pretty dang sure this is going to happen, okay? Okay, so here's exactly what they say. Warning of changes in solar activity, as well as monitoring of other astronomical anomalies and reorganizing our society accordingly, it is crucial for survival of our civilization. Increasing our adaptability to all scenarios of harsher environments should be a continuous endeavor, independent of the future solar conditions. So what they're saying is, regardless of what the solar conditions are or where we are within the cycle, we should keep our infrastructure, dwellings, and food production sovereignty adapted to the Maunder minimum. So we should be always ready for another Maunder minimum. Because what they're saying about this cycle that we're in, or this minimum that we are in, is it's going to be worse than they had it back in the 17th century. And possibly far worse. They're telling us to have 1 year's worth of food, okay, and provisions. They'd like you to have a concrete reinforced storm shelters, lighting protection, relocate people that are in high-risk zones. I mean, they're serious. These are the scientists that are saying this, not the FEMA, not the DHS. This is science that's telling us, look, get your shit together, because it doesn't look good. So it really doesn't matter what Trump's doing, and it really doesn't matter what any of them are doing, because none of that's going to matter if we hit into this grand solar minimum. Now, I wanted to tell you that all of my resources that I used tonight were from science resources. In other words, I put them through my media bias site, and they were all 100% factual with zero bias. So these were truly scientifically based resources, all of which I will list below and at the end of the video. And hey, don't forget to like and subscribe and share. Nana Prep out.